them if they're going to do a duet for us this morning. And so I'm going to ask Brother Ray and Miss Pam to come and sing, and may they bless our hearts this morning as we begin our worship. If you have your Bibles, you can already see you turn to 21st chapter of John as we're wrapping that up. And when they get through, we'll come on. Y'all come on and sing for us.
Testing one.
Yeah. You told me to turn
it off. Testing one.
That's it.
For the life of me, I cannot find a reason why a royal king would leave his throne. He looked down on humanity and loved us enough to dawn the hope of flesh and bone. He knew that they would walk in and they did. Our sacrifice. He knew the pain that waited on a rugged cross, till he came and paid the highest price.
For the life of me, I don't understand how he could move beyond my cause, love away my sin. For the life of me, I just cannot see why he would give me mercy when I was undeserving. How could he die just for the life of me?
I cannot find the answer. How one like him could care for me so much. Make me worthy of the price he paid for me with his own blood. But there on that old whipping post, he saw me. And he knew that I'd be lost without his grace. So in love he turned and climbed the hill, Golgotha, where he died upon a cross that bore my name. For the life of me, I don't understand how he could move beyond my cross, love away my sin. For the life of me, I just cannot see why he would give me mercy when I was undeserving. How could he die just for the life of me? When I was undeserving, how could he die just for the life of me? How could he die just for the life of me?
Thank you.
You know the other song we were going to do? Yeah, this song. Y'all keep knowing the right words, I'll lead you. That's all stand up and do. Victory in Jesus. I tell you, we need his victory nowadays. I tell you, the way things are going, this world won't change. We're in a terrible mess. Let's go. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me, I knew him, and no more love is through him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Amen. Thank you.
It's like Brother Ray said, the only hope that there is. Yes, I know the thing that we hear about so much in the world today is the election is coming up in just a short period of time. But folks, you need to understand that election is not going to be the answer, regardless of who you think ought to win. The only answer to changing this old world is the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no politician can fix what's going on in this world today. None. Not one. So thank you, Ray, Miss Pam, for coming and sharing with us this morning. If you have your Bibles, I want to just make an announcement about next Sunday. Next Sunday will be as normal morning, normal service, except immediately, and this is mainly for the folks here at Southside, immediately after the normal preaching service, we will have a short ordination service here for Brother Robbie. This will follow the preaching service. We'll not be on the air, but will be for the church congregation. So just wanted to make you aware of that. That's next Sunday night. So, if you have your Bibles and you found the last chapter in the book of John, I want you to stand with me as we read together about Jesus when he fixes the breakfast. I talked about that and speak on the subject of the reminder of failure. Let's begin reading in verse 9. As soon then as they were come to land, now, what's going on here? Disciples have been out fishing, hadn't caught anything. They were afraid. They were quitting preaching. They were going to do what they wanted to do. They were getting out of the church. They were going to go back in the world they came from. They were going to live the way they used to live. They were going to make the living the way they used to make the living. They did not. They were not going to go back the way that Jesus had told them and called them to do. That's where they're at. They just went fishing. That's what we preached on last Sunday. Now, things can change, and I think all of us know in a twinkling of an eye when Jesus shows up. And so what happens in this, it says, as soon, then, as they were in verse 9, they were come to the land, they saw a fire of coals there, fish laid thereon, and bread. Now Jesus said unto them, bring of the fish which ye have now caught. And Simon Peter went up and drew the net to the land full of great fishes, and 153. For all there were so many, yet was not the net broken. Then saith unto them, come and dine. None of the disciples durst ask him, who art thou? Knowing that it was the Lord. Jesus then cometh, taketh the bread, and giveth them, and fish likewise. This is now the third time that Jesus has showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. Father, thank you for the holy word. God, this message is an important message to all of us, because most of us at some point in time in our life have been a Peter. And God, we have to be reminded of where we were, and we have to be reminded of the promises that you have made us. And we have to be reminded, God, that you never planned any place or thing in our life that, God, you will not take us to. So, Lord, help us now that we might look at our... This is a message where, God, we don't need to look at anybody else, but, God, we just need to look at us. For it's in Christ's name that we do humbly pray. Amen. Amen. A reminder of failure. A reminder. Now, what happens, and the main crux of what this message is that this breakfast that Jesus has prepared for these disciples has a purpose for one man. That was Peter. Because remember, as I told you last Sunday, Peter had made up his mind that he was no longer go preach, that he was no longer go serve the Lord, that he was going to go back to his old ways. He was going back to his old job. He was going to take and make his living fishing again, and was removing himself from the call that God had placed on his life. And I told you, of all of the disciples, this one man, Peter, God had a special need for. And so in the nighttime, they're fishing. He shows himself, and one of them recognizes him. Peter jumps out of the boat, goes to see him. They had caught no fish. Jesus tells them to cast their net on the right side of the boat. And when they did, the Bible even knew the number of fish they caught. The Bible says that they caught 153 fish. To the number. Because God knows every fish in the sea. God knows every bird in the air. God knows every human being that's ever lived. There's nothing in the world that our God does not know today. And so when he looks and says, you don't have to take them out of the net and let me count them. I can tell you how many's in there. There's 153 in there. And so they bring the fish in. Now there is a purpose in this, because there is something that really needs to be done here. These men are down and out. Jesus, they haven't seen him in a little while. They don't think they can make it on their own in life. And so they're just going back to what they know. And yet what Peter didn't know was that God had something special planned in his life. But he could not grasp a hold that he was worthy to do what God wanted him to do. He said, I have preached and I have led people to the Lord, but now I don't have Jesus with me. So I'm going to go back what I know that I can do without him, and that's fish. Fish. And so at this point in time, the plan for Jesus, for Peter is this: what? When this chapter ends, Jesus is gone. When this chapter ends, God always had plans for the church to be the church. Well, the church always has got to have a leader to lead it. A leader to lead it. Peter was God's man, chosen by God to start the first church. And he, later on, we've studied this. He would take him to Jerusalem, and we've been through this on Wednesday night. But he had to get Peter's attention. Now, sometimes the way God has to get our attention is to take us back in our life to where we used to be. So the first thing that you read in that verse of Scripture, when they come into the shore, there is what there? A fire of coals. Now, when Peter went to that shore and he looked and he got out that boat and he walked up, and the first thing that he saw was a fire of coals. Probably the first thing that he thought, because this is only the second time that the term a fire of coals is mentioned in the Bible. And so he probably thought what? Let me tell you what he thought. You know the other time in the Bible where a fire of coals is mentioned? You remember the night before Jesus went on the cross to die for us? That Peter, who had told Jesus what? I don't care what the rest of this crowd might do. I don't care what these other disciples do. I don't care what they say. Lord, you might not can count on them, but I'll promise you what, God, you can always count on me. Oh, be careful. The rest of them might fail you, God, but I won't fail you. That's what Jesus heard from Peter. I'll always stand with you. But after he had come out of the trial and had been led out of the courtroom and he was walking through the courtyard there, he took a glance. And what did he see? The Bible says that he saw Peter standing by the coals of a fire, warming himself. So you see, that's the second. So that's the only two times in the Bible that that term is used, and both of them have to do with who? Peter. His denial. And what are we doing now with Peter? We finding him doing what? His second denial. He first says, Lord, I'll never leave you. Now he says, Lord, I'm not going to preach anymore. I'm going to hang it up. I'm going to get out the office, and I'm going to go take my boat out the shed, and I'm going back again. So both times when he saw the fire, it had to remind him of what? The times he said no to Jesus. The times he said no. We got to be reminded sometimes. And so he sets this out. Now, the Bible says in the Scripture, talking about this, that Peter had walked a far way from Jesus, that he had walked away. Folks, there is danger in distancing yourself from the Lord. Understand this. I do not care how, now listen. Of all the disciples that they were, the strongest one and probably the closest one to God was who? Peter. And yet what did Peter do? In a time of discouragement and disheartenment, what did he find himself doing? Drifting away from God. And the less he saw of Jesus, the further he drifted. There is always danger in drifting from God for the child of God. Always. The Bible in another scripture calls it walking at a guilty distance. And this is what has happened in Peter's life. He is not, well, he's not that fireball of a preacher that he used to be. He's not that one that's done the miracles. He's not the one that cast out the demons now. He has gone back into just a wimpy fisherman. That's what he is. How'd he get that? We sing a song. Many times we sing songs and we don't know the words or we don't pay attention to the words, but there's a song that says, just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Lord, let it be. Folks, I'm going to tell you, there are a lot of Christians that ain't walking where they need to be walking. There are a lot of Peters in the world that are walking at a distance from him. We're not close to him like we used to be. We're not where we used to be. We're walking at that distance. And so because they were at the distance from Jesus, you know, what caused the night, as I wrote there, to be such a tragic night? Because that last night, remember the last night that Jesus met them was the night that he was in the room and Thomas come in and he said, here, if you want to touch me, if you want to see the hole in my side, that was the last night they'd seen him. And then, boom, he was gone. And so for a couple of weeks or so, they sit in that room figuring, what am I going to do? Where am I going to go? How are we going to do this? We can't go out there and preach. You know why? Because people out there hate us. Listen, they just killed him a couple weeks ago. If we go out there preaching that same stuff about Jesus, they're going to kill us. So what do we do sometimes when there's trouble and there's trial and all? We'll always take the easy way out, don't we? And I want to tell you something. Most of the time, the easy way out will lead you away from Jesus. It will not lead you toward him. Because Jesus said, in this world you will have trials and troubles and tribulations, and that doesn't immune anybody. He said, if you follow me, you will have those things. So in the midst of a tragic night, he sees a fire, and it takes him back to where he had said this. I don't even know who he is. Denied him. I don't even know who he is. And then secondly, the reminder of failure, he looked at the fire, but then he looked down there at the fish and the bread. Is there anybody here that knows anything of the Bible that thinks that the fish and the bread do not mean anything to Peter? Do you remember back over, I believe it's in the 6th chapter of John, where the people were on the mountain and they were hungry and they were didn't have anybody to feed them. The Bible said there were 5,000 men there. That's not including the women and the children, but they were 5,000 of those there. And this little boy wanders up with a couple of pieces of bread and a few little old fish. Y'all know the story, don't you? Now, what did the disciples say? Which Peter was one of. We need to send these people home. See, that's what I do. If you come to my house looking for something to eat, most of the time I'm going to send you home. Because me and Lynn just keep enough for us. We don't feed the crowd. And we feed the cats and the hollies. And that's about all. Just joking. But we'll give you a honey bun. I promise you we got plenty of honey buns. Honey bun for breakfast, honey bun for lunch, and a honey bun for supper. I got a honey bun all day long. So that's just okay. Got that now. So he sees the fish and the bread. Now there's something I want you to notice about the fish. Now when they were feeding those fish on that mountain, tell me this. What did the disciples say to him? Send them people home. We got a basket of fish here. This won't feed all them people. Send them back where they come from. Let them get something else. And Jesus said, oh, no, 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 no. There's enough fish and bread in that basket to feed, and it's estimated that there were probably 20,000 people up there because it just said 5,000 men. That wasn't including their wives and their children and all. And he says, just keep reaching in there and you just keep serving and serving and serving. And they did that, and what happened? They had more than they knew what to do with. When he saw the fish and the bread, it was a reminder of what Jesus could do. Two little fish and a loaf of bread. It was a reminder to him of the power of God, of how he had seen God work in the middle of a test, in the middle of the trial. And yet we see that he was reminded of this in this time. You see, Simon Peter needed to be reminded. I can do a miracle still. Now, what was the miracle? I'm going to ask you a question, see if you can get this. I haven't told you the answer yet. But there's a miracle happening right now in front of their eyes. Anybody know what it is? What? Norma, who told you that?
I have taught this lesson about me.
What? The miracle is that there's fish already in the pan frying. The 153 that they had brought in and caught, where are they at? They're still in the net. He didn't need their fish. He already had them. Some at point in time when he saw them through the night, Jesus said, come on, fish, I need you now. And they come out of the water and got there and got in the pan and started frying. That's what happened. I'm telling you, Jesus didn't fish and catch them normal. He called them in like he called them into that net, and they went and got in that net. He called them in, they jumped in the frying pan and started frying. That's right. I really believe that happened. Put a little grease in there, and so what they didn't see, they were talking about the miracles he had performed, and we're standing right in the presence of a miracle that he was performing right then, and they did not even recognize it. They did not even recognize it. And so he reminded Simon Peter of these things. And he reminded him that he could perform another miracle. And the thing that I think that it reminded Peter of, number three, the most, was what? All of the things that God had done for him. The bread, the fish frying, the fish in the net, are all things that he could not have done without God blessing him. These things were miracles that God had done in his life. Peter was a man that had done miracles himself. Remember the man that was lame when they were walking by the temple? And people wouldn't throw him money out and give him money and make fun of him. And Peter told him to what? To stand up and rise up and walk. And he jumped up and down and hollered because he was so happy that he could walk again. And then he ran into the temple just screaming and hollering, praising the Lord for what he'd done. Peter done this afterwards. Listen, sometimes when we want to turn our back on God, sometimes when we might want to turn our back on the church because maybe somebody said something hurt your feelings. Maybe the church did something you didn't particularly like. And so you just want to turn your back on it and go the other way. You'd rather think of Peter here. Because that's exactly what Peter had done. He turned his back on Jesus. He turned his back on this. And all of a sudden God says, I know how to get him back. See, if God wants you, he knows how to get you. He can do it good. He can do it in another way and do it not so good. But if he wants you back, he knows how to test you. So then Peter began to think. You know, the years I walked with the Lord were 3.5 years. You think of the most glorious 3.5 years of your life. Can you put together in any time frame of your life 3.5 years that you think were probably the best 3.5 years you ever had? I can't do that. I thought about that when I was doing this message. Because I've had a lot of good years, really great years. I've had some years that we endured. But the Bible says he that endures will make it to the end. So we're going to make it to the end regardless of what comes. But Peter began to think. He said, you know what? The greatest 3.5 years of my life was the time that I walked close to God. The greatest 3.5 years of my life was the time that I followed close, when I walked with him and I did what he told me and I saw him do the miracle. I was there when he raised Lazarus from the dead. I have seen him do things that no other man is due. I have seen in 3 years things that people will live a lifetime and they will never witness, but I have seen them because of him. And he began to think back of all the good times. And he began to think probably of the failures. Because the one thing about Jesus, he never chooses perfect people to work for him. You know, several of you own your own companies and stuff in here. And you can go to ZipRecruiter. Right? If you need an employee, brother, you can go to ZipRecruiter and they'll... I don't know how to do it. I ain't been a ZipRecruiter. The only zipper I know is the one I got. ZipRecruiter, all these things, and you go hire somebody. What are you looking for when you hire somebody? Will he work hard? Will he be honest? Does he have character about him? Will he do what I tell him to do? Will he be faithful to the work that I'm hiring him to do? Or is that not what you look for when you're hiring somebody? Or are you looking for somebody that's going to steal from you? When you ain't there, they're going to sit on their fannies and not do nothing. They're going to do this. Who are you looking for to hire? Well, Jesus had a little hiring difference than most people. Jesus hired, in many cases, the worst of the worst, didn't he? He didn't go to the seminary and say, I'll tell you what I want. I want the top. Who are the top 10 scores in this seminary here that's graduated with the top honors? I'm fixing to put together a 12 band of men that's going to turn the world upside down. I need the 10 best you got. I mean, what he did. He didn't go to Greece where all the wise philosophers and all of those that know so much about the world and all and say, who are the best 10 philosophers that you've got in the world? I need 12 disciples and I need the 12 best you've got. That's not what he did. He wanted me, and he wanted you, and he wanted Peter, and he wanted James, and he wanted John. What were they? Their names are not found written in the great novels of history. They're found in the Bible. Jesus chose the foolish things of this world to confuse the wise of this world. You know the reason they couldn't figure out Jesus? You see, most of these people come into our church, we wouldn't even let them in. You think if Apostle Paul had come here in this church before he met Jesus on that Damascus road, and even after we'd heard he'd done tore down this church in Sumter and that church in Sumter and that church over yonder, that we would let this man come in and be a part of our congregation? No! But Jesus said, he's going to be my special disciple. I'm going to save him. I'm going to turn his life around. I'm going to take him. He really thinks he's something, but I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to take that pride he's got. He's wealthy, he's rich, he's educated and all that, and I'm going to take all that away from him where he's got to give all of that up if he's willing to follow me. And Paul said, Lord, what would you have me to do? And he gave it all up. Peter. He said, come and I will make you a fisher of men. I'll make you a preacher. Peter said, I don't have the conversation there. I can imagine Peter saying this. Me be a preacher. I don't know who you are. How I'm going to preach about you when I don't even know you? Because when Peter and Jesus met, they didn't know each other. How am I going to preach about somebody that I don't know? And then Peter probably said this. Preacher, I don't even go to church. You know where I'm at on Sundays? I'm fishing. Golfing. At the lake. At the beach. Somewhere. But it ain't been at the church, I can tell you that. Peter said. But God said, but Peter, you the man I'm looking for. You know who I think respects salvation more than anybody else does? Those who brought from the lowest places. Those that were sunk the deepest in sin. Those that nobody else said there was a hope for. Those that said he'll never be nothing but a drunk. He'll never be nothing. She'll never be nothing but an old. Well, my mama used to say, well, she ain't going to never be nothing but old hussy. That's all she's ever been. Any of y'all ever heard that term? Sometime now they call them Jezebel. Mama used to call them old hussies. That's all she's ever going to mount to, John. She ain't going to never be nothing. She goes around and she sleeps with this one and she sleeps with that one. She does this and that. Well, you know what? Jesus had a lot of people like that in his life. Now, we're going to finish this in a couple of weeks. I'm going to take you on a journey. And what you go find out starting that journey of was, you go back to the lifeline and go through Jesus' family lineage, and you go find that Jesus, that his family wasn't all that either. We think about David and all of them, but I'm here to tell you, he had some rough characters in his lineage too. That's the next study we'll be doing. But he carried him back. Took old Peter, that one that nobody else would probably ever thought about calling. And Jesus in verse 12 says, come and die. And none of the disciples even asked, who art thou? Knowing that it was the Lord. Because nobody could have done what had already happened. And he took the bread, and the Bible says he gave it to them, and the fish likewise. That term, coming down. In our failures, we often need to be reminded, and I want everyone to listen to this, and we all, there's not anybody in this building today that has not failed him at some point in time. I cannot even count the times that I know that I disappointed him, that I disappointed my wife, that I disappointed my family, that I disappointed my mom and daddy. Hey, I can't. You know what? My memory is not very good anymore. And I'm not joking with y'all. But you know, there's some things I'm glad I can't remember. I can't remember back all the times I disappointed that lady just walked out that door there. All the times I disappointed that one that loved me so much and forgave me so much when I was young and didn't know how to be a husband and didn't know how to be the father that I needed to be and didn't live like I needed to live and didn't go with her to church and do things, and yet she still loved me anyway. I can't remember them days, but I know it had to happen because she's still with me. I know how I was, but I don't know how she put up with it. She had to have a love in her heart like Jesus had, or she'd have kicked me to the curb. But he told those disciples, come. Come. You know that little old word right there, that's a little short little word. other than grace, mercy, faith, and forgiveness and salvation. That may be the greatest word in the Bible. Come. Get out of your boat. Breakfast is ready. Come on and eat. And they were wet, and they were cold, and they were tired. That's like we get in life sometimes. We get tired. We get wet. Life puts a drain on you sometimes. And they came to him. Now, there is a difference here that I want you to know. Remember, this is the second time that Peter's been. I remember the main point of this is Peter. The first time that he said with the fire and the coals, he says to Peter, come and see. Still got the same word, come. This time he says to Peter what? Come and die. Peter, you come and see. Now it's Peter, you come and dine with me. You sup with me. You breakfast with me. You do those things with me. You know, in the Bible, that little word come. You remember a man named Noah? Oh, this is an important word. A man named Noah. And you know who he was and his family. And God was fixing to destroy the world. And what does he say to Noah and his family? Come, thou and all of thy family into the ark. Come to the ark. In Isaiah, it says this. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. And then one of the greatest times it is used in the Bible is in the words of Jesus when he says, come all ye that are weak and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And another time he says this, this is the one I love, whosoever will, let him come. That means I died for everybody. You see, I know there are people that believe in predestination. I know there are people that are Calvinists that believe that God has determined salvation for this group of people and he hadn't got salvation for that group of people. And I think all of that's a bunch of bunk because I am a whosoever will preacher, and I believe that God said whosoever will, let him come. Let him come. That don't mean how bad you've been. He didn't say, well, if you've done this, you can't come. Or if you've done that, you can't come. He said, whosoever will. Everybody can come. Anybody can come. No matter what you might have done in your life. You have not done enough that God will not save you. Well, preacher, you don't know. I've done a lot of really bad things. Well, I'm here to tell you, I got a really great Savior. And no matter how bad your things have been, my Savior's great enough to forgive them today. That's it. And the last point four. It's God's invitation. I can imagine Jesus knowing these fellows like he does. This is an old saying, too. John, he used to say the way to get to a man's heart is through his stomach. You ever heard that? Can she cook? So I got to marry a woman that cooks because I don't cook. And so the way to my heart, among other things, was she could cook. Jesus, he might not can cook. I don't know where he did cook, but he could always have things cooked, right? And so he says, fellas, are you hungry today? You see, there's several kind of hungers we can have, and we'll close with this. To the person that does not know if they're going to heaven or not, you cannot tell me that that person does not, and if they come to church or somebody witnesses to them and they hear the word of God, you cannot tell me that that person does not have some kind of hunger in their soul that they know that they need to take care of. There's a hunger there. God created you and God made you with that hunger in you, a desire for Him. God put in every man a desire for Him. That does not mean every man's going to come to Him. But He put that hunger in there for you. And then there's that person that's hungry because life is unsatisfied. They're at a place, and a point in their life where there's not much peace. They're at a place in their life where they're worried about what's going to happen after the virus is gone. Are worried if the virus is going to go. They're just not satisfied with the condition that they're in right now. And they need a word from the Lord to like He is with these disciples, saying, it's going to be okay. I can fix you fish and bread. I can feed you. I can take care of you. God made me that promise many years ago. He said, I'll never leave you. And I'll never forsake you. Listen, you'll never have so much of a need that I can't fix it because I own the cattle of 1,000 hills. I own it all. And you're my child. But there are a lot of people in this world that are not happy. They don't have a lot of joy. And then there are those that are worried about failure. They don't know where the road of life's going to lead them. John, you mind if I use you for example? Because you don't know how many cars you go sell next week, do you? No, I ain't making a joke. I'm being serious. You don't know whether you're going to sell 2 or none or 10. So you live by faith, believing that whether you know it or not, every day you get up and you go there and live by faith because you don't know what's going to happen that day. You may come home with a smile on your face and tell Sherry, I sold 2 today, or you may go a whole week and say, honey, I hate to tell you this, but it's tough, right? We got to learn to live by faith. But yet, you know, I look at you now, and through that, and I've known you all my life, just about it, and I bought cars from you, and y'all still here. Through all the wondering and the hoping and all the things that you have to deal with in life. You know what? I look at this church and these people here. We're over half full today. You're still here. You didn't have to come to church this morning, but you did. Forgiveness. I think one of the greatest problems, and this is the last thing, because you can see it up there. Don't mean I'm through it, just means it's the last thing up here. Y'all know that. Don't mean I'm through, that just means that's the last thing on the note there. One of the greatest failures that we ever have in life is the failure of unforgiveness. You look at those disciples. They had that problem. They had that problem. They couldn't get along with each other all the time. They fussed and fought. Just like church people do. Most time, what it amounts to ain't a healing being, but we'll go crazy over them. Which pew we go put these ribbons on, Jimmy? Well, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't like this. You got my pew covered up, and I sit in that pew every Sunday. And y'all done strung this ribbon across here, and I can't sit there. So if I can't sit in my pew, I ain't coming back no more. Do y'all think anybody would say that? Hey, I done seen it done. Don't tell me it won't happen. Forgiveness. See, the thing is, you got to walk up there and say, the people in my seat, but I'm going to sit over here today. I've been in church where I've seen them just stand there and ask them to leave and get up out of their seat. You know what I'm talking about. Y'all need to move. I sit there all the time. Visitors that come in to visit your church and somebody tells them to get up and move. Y'all life, I've seen it a lot of times. And I want to do this. I don't see your name on this pew nowhere. And I don't see no $100 bills laying on it where you bought it. That's what I want to say. But I'm a nice guy. Don't laugh at that. That ain't supposed to be funny. Just strange. 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 That's right. There you go. That's right. We are. That's right. Gotcha. But learning to forgive. That's one thing Jesus had to teach his disciples. That's one thing he had to teach Peter. Because Peter was tough now. Peter could be cold now. I remember one time Peter asked the Lord this. He said, Lord, how many times should I forgive this Tom Bosho or whatever his name is here? He's made me so mad I done thugged my glasses or what. He made me so mad. I don't care if he don't ever come back to church again. You know what he said to me? He said, that's the sorriest sermon he ever heard. And every time I see him, I remember one time Junior Hill said, told Junior Hill is a evangelist. He's an older man now. Junior's probably in the 80s. I doubt if he's preaching now. He's still alive, I think. But he was talking about forgiving people. And he said one time, now this is probably a lie. Even though he's a preacher, preachers will lie every once in a while. My, well, that's a nice way of putting it. She said, I just exaggerate. Other people call it a lie, but my wife's a sweetie. She calls it an exaggeration. I mean, people you have, we had about 70 there in Oklahoma. She said, you know, there wasn't 30 people there. Well, it looked like 70 people there, you know, whatever. But Junior Hill said this. He was at a revival one time. And this woman came in the door, and he was standing back there talking to the preacher, and he looked at her. He kind of turned to the preacher, and he said, that right there is about the ugliest woman I ever seen in my life. I can't hardly turn around and look at her. She's so ugly. Preacher says, but she heard him. She heard what he said. And he said every time that he went back to that church, he walked in that door, he seen that woman. And he said, the first thing that come to my mind when I saw her was what I said about her. You know, forgiveness comes when we see people sometimes that we haven't forgiven or haven't forgiven us. Forgiveness comes sometimes we get to go to a place where we fail the Lord and we had to seek His forgiveness. Forgiveness comes sometime when you get around a people that messed your life up and you need to forgive them of it. Don't y'all think that forgiveness is one of the hard things to do in life? Because we think everybody's like Jesus when everybody isn't like Jesus. So as we have our hymn of invitation, His name is going to come and lead us. Amazing Grace. I'm going to say to you the same thing that Jesus said to those disciples. Come. Come and dine. Eat with the Lord. Listen to His call. They could have stayed out there all night and not called anything, but they listened to what Jesus said and they came. And I'll tell you what, they changed and the world changed, and you and I are here today because of that moment in time in history. Do you know that? We're here today because of that moment in time in history that Peter started back following You may be here today, and number one, I'll ask you this. Soon and very soon, this old world's going to close down. And it'll be too late to ask God to come into your heart and forgive you. And so, I want to ask you, if you don't know the Lord, you're not certain you're going to heaven, then I'll tell you, your time is short and time's running out for this old world. Would you come today and join Jesus? And like we said, this altar is open. We could go keep this. We had this altar last Sunday. People came. Because you know why? They needed to pray. They needed to talk to God. That's what that altar's for. That's what kneeling at these pews are for. We've got people that we've got to love that we can't just pray for them one day. We probably have to pray for them every day. Every day. The Bible says never to cease praying, doesn't it? And so as we had this, maybe you've lost your joy. Maybe this old world's taking away your joy because you're living about tomorrow and worried about tomorrow and whatever. So it's hard to live with peace in your life. And listen, yet God said He will give you peace. You can put your trust in Him. Maybe you need to say, God, strengthen my peace. My peace has done got weak. Come, I will pray with you. Come at this altar and let's pray whatever you need for God to do. The fishes and the bread, God can do anything that you need done. Maybe you want to join the church, whatever. Coronavirus don't keep us from doing anything God calls us to do. You need to remember that. Father, thank you for this special time. Now, God, as we come to the time of the invitation, for that one, God, that's got something on their heart or got somebody on their heart, that God, that needs to just do a special time of prayer, God, that we'll meet down at this altar. God, for that one that may be here today that would be honest. They were like Peter. They've drifted away a little bit. Kind of gone back where they come from, just like he had. But God, they need to come today and rededicate that life to you. God, that's what this altar's for. That's what I'm here for. God, for that one today that for some reason this old hard sin, dark world we live in has stripped them of the joy of their salvation. God, they sit there with worry and they sit there wondering what tomorrow's going to be or the next day. God, I pray you'd be with them. That they would come. To that one that may be thinking about joining a church or joining this church, that God, today would be that great day. Lord, bless us now in this, and may the Holy Spirit of God move in this invitation. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with us together as we sing Amazing Grace? You got a prayer request? You hit this altar. Thank you, Brother Tom. Thank you, Brother Tom. You got something you need for God to do? You got somebody that needs your prayers? Come talk to the Lord about it today. You want to know what God wants you to do in your life? Today's the time to do it. I got one more word for you. Don't forget tonight. All right, we started a new series on the end times. We started a series on the prophecy of Daniel, the prophet, for today. We just finished up Revelation. Now remember something, Revelation is about what's going to happen. Daniel is the prophecy of what's happening. That he prophesied this day, centuries ago. And we just started it last Sunday night. And so if you want to see today's world and the prophecy of the one man of God that Jesus said was the man of wisdom, and we'll be in our second lesson on Daniel tonight. You come be with us at 6 o'clock. And thank you for being here today, and you are dismissed.